Hello and welcome to NewsClick. In today's episode of Talking Science and Tech, we are joined by Prabir Prakayastha, and the issue we are discussing today is the question of access to knowledge and the question of access to science. So three of the biggest publishing houses in the world, Elsevier, American Chemical Society, and Wiley have just come together to sue two websites, Sci-Hub and LibGen, demanding that an injunction against them. So Prabir, to start with, can you tell us about this case? Who are these two websites and why are these three big publishing houses which rake in huge amounts of profits every year, why are they suing Sci-Hub and LibGen?
Well, it's an interesting issue, because while everybody accepts that access to knowledge is a human right, that's in fact something which is also said under the United Nations, all of that is true. But the reality is that if you want to access publications in science or in social sciences, then they are behind paywalls. And most of those paywalls that are there, it's quite expensive to pay for particularly individual copies of papers, let alone a journal, access to a journal individually, or for even the universities or the colleges to subscribe to them. So some of the better ones do have the money, and it's a lot of money to subscribe to them. But most of the research scholars depend on Sci-Hub for the science journal publications, which is essentially for their research. So let's assume that a research scholar in a year has to look at least 100 research articles, if not more. So if you take an average cost of the article to be about $30, which would be lower end of the price, you're really talking of something like $3,000 per year for a research scholar, which is not even equivalent to the scholarship he receives. So you're really talking of a completely inequitable system in which research scholars, particularly coming from universities, who do not have a large number of subscription to journals, and who do not avail of what are called package deals with the publishers, where they can avail all the journals. So if that is so, then most cases they would have to depend on Sci-Hub, which is the global repository for all science journals or even social sciences journals. And more than the fact that it is free, that means it's not charging anything, this is not for profit. They're not doing this for profit at all. The lady who is in charge or who runs this place says that she believes it's completely predatory practice to deny science to people, scientific research to people who need to develop it further. Therefore, she is running essentially a pirate publication house. But it is free for everybody. So given that, obviously people have turned to Sci-Hub for their research articles. But interestingly, even those universities which have access to journals through their university system, even there, the number of downloads from Sci-Hub seem to be very large. And that's because it's a one-stop shop. You go there, and any journal access that is available there is much easier to use. So I wonder why the publishing houses, which publish all these journals, do not make their sites more easy to navigate. And the reason for that is very simple. They have various ways of restricting you so that without paying a sum of money, you can't get in. And they have to verify all of that. So all the kind of restrictions that exist on the site, of course, makes it much more difficult for people to avail of the facilities of these, even the publishers, even if they are under the university system, accessible to these websites. They find it much more difficult to download the papers from them. And therefore, Sci-Hub becomes, even for them, an easier option. So I think it has various elements to it. I'm not getting into the LibGen today, because I think LibGen is basically for the books. Of course, that has a much larger set of books and issues to talk about. But here we are talking about advances in science. And the important point for us to realize, advances of science are not done by the publishers. They're being done by the scientific community, and they are the ones who publish the papers, and the ones who require it are also the scientific community. So the publishers, in fact, are standing as doorkeepers of the research which the scientific community does and also needs for its own development.
So the other question that arises here is that why are these papers so expensive in the first place? So in their petition to the Delhi High Court, these three publishers say that motivations of Sci-Hub and LibGen are not to facilitate research, study, instruction, or education, but to freeload on the hard work, skill, and labor of the publishers and their authors. So what is it exactly that the publishing house here is doing, which requires, you know, which makes these their final output so expensive, and how much is being given to the authors?
The interesting part is they're talking about freeloading. The Sci-Hub is not generating any revenue, so it is not freeloading. It is making things available free. You may object to it, but you cannot call it freeloading. When it comes to the publishers, then of course they are the one who are doing freeloading, because the scientific research is done by the scientists under salaries paid by the universities, the government, by other institutions. So they don't have anything to do with the research that is being done. The publication, the author writes it up for publication. Again, the publisher doesn't really come in. It is refereed by the scientific community. All of this is free. It's not that the writer gets any payment. Even the referee who actually looks at the article, makes comment, even that is free. And finally, when it is published, only then the publisher comes in, taking the manuscript. And they have very strict rules that you have to make it. If you do graphics, you have to do it in this format. If you do the article, it has to be either in this format and that format. So they sort of force the authors to do most of the work. And then, of course, the transfer to digital format by which it can be distributed, that's done by the publisher. Does it warrant this kind of cost? And I'll give you one simple example to show how predatory this business has become. And this is really the transformation of scientific publishing by Maxwell, a British entrepreneur and a freebooter who finally committed suicide because he had siphoned off $400 million from the employees' pension funds. He's the one who converted what is to be staid, sober business of publishing into this kind of predatory publishing that we now see, which Elsevier, of course, is the linchpin, but so is Wiley and a couple of others. Now, when you see the transformation that has taken place, it's interesting. In the last 10, 15, 20 years, for example, if you see the rise of the what would be called the index, the price index, then you would see it's risen by maybe 118-120% is roughly the rise of the price index. But if you take the price of the journals, they have risen by something like over 500%. So that shows there is super profits being made in this particular sphere of business. Second part, the profit margin of Elsevier is 37%. Now that is twice the profit margin, almost twice the profit margin of Google, which is 19%. And Google is one of the most profitable companies in the world, and we know that. So if we are talking about big money, this is a $10 billion business of scientific publication. So it's not a small segment of business, but I think the important part to understand is it is what powers the rest of the world's development. So if you take science and technology as a major driver of the economy, as a major driver of society today, it is that knowledge which the scientific community is providing, in which these publishers are acting as gatekeepers and charging essentially exorbitant price and super profits. And the problem again is that maybe it's possible in the for the universities in advanced countries to pay this kind of cost, but certainly not in countries like India, Iran, which are the major centers of science research, as can be seen by the publications and downloading of the publications. But as I said, it's interesting, even in the advanced countries, the university libraries, universities are now saying we can't pay these prices. And there have been cases where major university systems, like University of California, for instance, decided to cancel all the subscriptions to Elsevier. And this is not a lone example. There are other examples also. So this is increasingly becoming apparent that this task of providing the papers, doing the research, checking the quality of the papers, and then paying for it again is, as a model, is not something which is sustainable. And I think this is the reason that these publishing houses are going for exorbitant prices. No, they know it's a short-term model, it won't last for too long. And then failing that, they are now trying to see that companies like, or organizations, entities like Sci-Hub, which are essentially liberating that information for the public, is then stopped. And because they can't stop it where it exists, we don't know where the Sci-Hub person who's done it, where she lives, and therefore trying to block the website, asking the ISPs to block the website. This is the legal strategy they have taken. Whether this strategy is legally going to succeed or not, we'll have to see. Because I think people need to react to this, because if it happens, it's really going to set back Indian science in a huge, in a big way. And we don't have the money, particularly the smaller universities and institutions won't have the money to pay what Sci-Hub, Elsevier and others are asking for. So given that, I think we are in for some hard times if this, what they have asked for, the prayer to block the ISPs, ask the ISPs to block Sci-Hub and its various avatars takes place. So I think that's something that we'll have to watch. Will it hold? Well, you know, there are VPN possibilities that exist. So even if it's blocked in India, it won't be blocked elsewhere. So we'll have to see whether how many can really avail of that. But these are things which are far more structurally important. And I think that is what needs, the scientific community has to decide how it will maintain its relationship with the publishers. Because this is at the moment is a no-go for the scientific community. They do all the work and then they are, you know, they are asked to pay huge amounts for the work they have done. That's not a viable long-term solution for this.
And finally, Prabir, what do you think is the legal way forward? Is there a defense here? Do you think the court will acknowledge the ground reality that what this could mean for researchers and how it could impact scientific development and act on their behalf?
Well, you know, the law has various provisions, because even in the United States, they could not get the sites blocked. So ISPs did not block the sites. So there is, the legal issue is not as straightforward as it might appear on first instance. It has to be shown that the only purpose of Sci-Hub is basically providing articles which are under copyright. Now, as we know, there are a huge number of articles which are not under copyright in India, but these publishers will not give us access to them, saying they are under copyright in Europe or in the United States. We have a 60-year regime of copyright. There are also educational exceptions that we have, that for the purpose of education, there are exceptions that we can take care of in the copyright law. And therefore, if I need it for my research and I need to download a copy, is that illegal? No. Is it illegal for Sci-Hub to provide it to me? That is the legal test that we have to see. As I said, it's not as straightforward. We had the copyright infringement case, which was pursued against photocopying in Delhi University, and that the publishers lost. This issue is not just going to be a legal one. It's also going to test what the scientific community in India says. And one part of it, while they have been deeply indebted by the existence of Sci-Hub, are they willing to speak in its favor? Or do they think actually it is theft and therefore we should not speak about it, to be seen to be condoning theft? I think we have to make it very clear that knowledge is universal. The right to knowledge is universal. It has been created by scientific community. They have not put a price on it. The publishers had a business model which allowed this knowledge to be retrieved in a way which was equitable, that yes, we paid some money, but it was reasonable, then the existence of Sci-Hub might not have come about. But having not done that, now to try and come down on the users. Essentially, this is what will happen. The users will have to pay the price. She doesn't have to pay the price. The owner of Sci-Hub is not going to pay the price. The rest of the world is downloading papers from Sci-Hub, and it will continue to do so. But the Indian scientific community, which is not small, it's quite a large one, will pay a heavy price. And if you go and look at the downloads, you will see India, Iran, of course, United States also, and some of the European countries are the largest users of Sci-Hub. So it's not that this is something which is a marginal use for marginal issue for India. For the Indian scientific community, if the courts really look at a very narrow interpretation of this, then I think that it will lead the scientific community to be India to be really hard hit, and our research to be very hard hit. And I think that's the issue. As you know, even I or you, when we want to look at some of the papers, we don't subscribe to all of them, but for wanting to know what has happened, we need to look at some of them. And of course, we do use platforms like this to see what material is there.
Thank you, Prabhi, for speaking to us on this issue today. And that's all the time we have. Keep watching NewsClick.